good shot. Oh my!
Yeah, to celebrate Georgetown, the Georgetown Raiders are Buckland Cup champions!
The Trenton Golden Hawks, the R-7-2-8 Cup champions are going to Coburn.
Back to Minerva. Shot scores! And the Coburn Cougars are the World Bank Cup champions!
Well, not too long ago, the Georgetown Raiders had a 13-point lead over Buffalo for first place in the West, but the hard-charging Sabres whittled that down to just 2 last weekend in Georgetown. More on that coming up later on in the show. This is the OJ Today. Welcome, everyone. I'm Alex Bastiavansky. On today's show, Zach Hyman has become an integral part of the resurgent Toronto Maple Leafs, and he used the OJHL as a springboard towards achieving his NHL dreams, and we'll have a feature story on the former Hamilton Red Wing later on in the show. Also, Alex Bloomfield joins me to chat about the much-improved Whitby Fury. But first, OJ highlights, and the Newmarket Hurricanes have been in a 3-way battle with Aurora and Markham for supremacy in the North all season long. Just a single point separated them and the Tigers heading into last weekend, so it was essential they pick up a W against the Kingston V's. OJ Highlights now brought to you by Cool Sports, official apparel provider to the OJHL. The Kingston has a hill to climb if they want to catch Wellington for first in the East. Good start for them, though. Power play 627 in. Cameron Pound Rister makes it 1-0 for the V's. Second period now. Canes keeper Fraser Kirk comes up with what might be the play of the week, one of the saves of the year. Watch as he spins and gets his paddle back to rob Josh LeBlanc. What a save. Third period, the ice was still wet when Claudio De Gasperis, a bit of a softy on the backhander there that squeaks through Trevor Withers, all knotted up at one apiece, and that sent things into overtime. Scary moment here as De Gasperis charges the net, collides with Withers. The keeper's mask comes flying off. Thankfully, both guys were okay, though. Soon after,
away from some pressure now. Lays it across. Sheldon Nolan scores! That's all it took, man! A seeing eye shot from the point, and the Hurricanes pick up the 2 points.
Anthony Regan with the call. Newmarket snatches the 2 points, and they remain neck and neck with Aurora for first in the North. Okay, another northern battle here. Stouffville visited Markham. All Royals in this one. 5:30 in. Brett Oudekerk. Rister passed Andrew Albano to make it 1-0 Markham. And then just before the break, Lucas Condotta to Jonathan Krasnajak. The twine, it bulges. Royals up 2-0 at intermission. Second period now. One of the best members bounces we've seen in a while comes right to Justin Bennett. When it rains, it pours. Things just could not go any worse for Stouffville at this point. 3-0. And then it's the Royals on the power play. Condotta teeing it up from the point. And kaboom, the one-timer past Albano. 4-0 for Markham. Just over a minute later, though, Stouffville hits the score sheet finally on the PP. Seeing eye shot from the point by Jordan Jackman. And the deficit is cut to 4-1. All Royals in the third frame, though. Justin Bennett showing off the dishpan soft hands here. And yeah, wow. 5-1 for the blue and white. Finally, a brutal, I mean brutal, giveaway by Stouffville as they gift wrap it for Alessio Luciani. All Markham, 6-1 final. And a newly acquired keeper, Nate McDonald, was a happy man in his first game as his workload was pretty light. And yeah, he's feeling pretty at home with his new team so far.
Felt pretty good. The guys made it really easy for me. They kept shots to the outside. Everyone's been really welcoming. Right from Coach Galati, Coach Drew, all the way down to the guys, my billets, everyone's been great. So it was a really smooth transition. And yeah, like I said, it was just guys kept the pucks to the outside, made it easy for me, and I felt like I played a pretty good game tonight.
Okay, the Junior Sabres looking to keep pace with Georgetown in the West. They took on the GRCs. We pick it up in the second. Toronto up 1-0, not the prettiest goal you'll ever see. But Christian DeFelice says, thanks anyway. All tied up at one apiece. Late in the period, the Canadians biding their time here. Matthew O'Brien out front calls for it. And puts it home, and the GRCs retake the lead 2-1. Christian Matthias bailing out his boys at the other end as first he robs sniper Adam Trudowitz, and then moments later, he will repeat the feat on the poor Buffalo Junior Sabre player right there. Two nice stops. Third period, though, the Sabres do not adopt. Midway through, on the power play, Anthony Hora gets all of that one, and it's tied up 2-2. Canadians with a chance to win it late, but it was Brian George's turn to come up big as he robs Jason Pinio on the breakaway. So it was off to overtime, where it was George saving the day again, point blank on David Sherman, a play of the week. But George could only do so much. At the 308 mark, look at the patience by Chad Lopez. Uses Turchiev as a decoy and slams it home for the winner. Habs win. Watch as he catches George cheating off the post just a bit there. So two huge points for the Canadians. And they stay in the race for supremacy in the South, although Oakville and the Patriots are threatening to pull away from the pack right now. Alumni update. Former Georgetown Raider Liam Clare named AHC Defensive Player of the Week. He's with Sacred Heart. Daniel Minella, who had stints with four different OJ teams, named ECAC Player of the Week. He's with St. Lawrence. And Brett Senny, formerly of Kingston, now with Merrimack, named Hockey East Player of the Week. OJ trivia. Which OJ player was named the 2016-17 CJHL Top Forward? That's for the whole country. First correct answer to our Morocco at the OJHL.ca wins a prize pack. Hey folks, welcome back to the OJ today. Joining me now via Skype is Alex Bloomfield, Pickering Panthers play-by-play man, and a guy who just generally covers the entire Northeast Conference of the OJHL. Alex, welcome back to the show, buddy. How were the holidays? Did you have a good time?
They were great. Snowy, cold, and back in the London, Ontario area for a few days. So yeah, definitely a good time off.
Of course, you guys get hit a lot worse out there than we do in the Toronto area for sure. So glad you had a nice white Christmas, as did we back home. Today we're going to talk about the Whitby Fury, who have been one of the more interesting teams in the league this year, of course, because they started off terribly. 3 wins in their first 25 games, which some teams have bad starts, but I think that shocked a lot of people that they started that slowly this year. In your mind, from what you saw, what was behind the slow start for Whitby?
I think honestly, it was just the whole regime change in the offseason when you go from McCrory over to Pearson as far as the management level. They did a lot of turnover, but there were some returning guys. Just the whole structure was changed in the offseason. They came back in. They lost a lot of their key guys from that team that was basically third in the Northeast last year. It was just slow getting together, slow chemistry building. Once you start winning, once you start losing, it's hard to stop doing both. It's a streaky game at times, and I think they just didn't come together, and it was a little bit too late. They kind of got down on themselves, and it took a little while to right the ship.
Since that time, though, they've been one of the better teams in the league. They've played well above the 500 level and turned things around huge. Now they're actually back in the playoff hunt, trying desperately to catch your team that you cover, the Pickering Panthers, who right now are holding down that last eighth playoff spot. What's been behind the resurgence in your eyes behind Whitby's play lately?
Well, they finally strung some wins together there at the end of October. Honestly, they just brought in a lot of other assets and a few trades they made. But that was the main thing. I think they brought in some new blood. I think about 4 or 5 players that were getting regular time in the lineup that were, you know, had some OJHL experience. Got a new group together. They started working in through the Rob Pearson system, and just turning things around slowly. It hasn't been like they've rammed off 10 or 11 in a row, but they've been able to just basically play a little over 500, win some games against teams that they're chasing, and slowly make their way back up through the pile. And now they're sitting ninth and knocking on the door.
And a little bit of an odd thing, like you mentioned last time you were on the show, is they trade top defenseman Mason Snell, who's committed to Penn State, one of the top defensemen in the OJHL, if not Canadian Junior A hockey. And they've actually played much better since that trade, haven't they?
Yeah, they have. That was one of the really three trades you could look to. I think that was probably the biggest one from Wellington. They get Rory Milne, they get Mark Kennedy, they get Nick Duras-Lilia, all those guys contributing on this Wellington roster since that point. Then you have the Brock Welsh trade a few days later. You bring back Jeffrey Gall, you bring back Jason Stachelbeck and Greg Smith. And then Dylan Laddie, they managed to turn Stephen Elliott, who was not reporting after that trade with Pickering, they were able to turn that into Dylan Laddie, who's been a real force up front for them as well. So they just pulled in these guys. And yeah, even trading away a top prospect like Mason Snell obviously helps you out. When you turn him into three players, they're able to insert in the lineup. It's a team game. It really, really can help your team.
You mentioned Stachelbeck, and he's just been a revelation since coming over. He was one of the hottest snipers in the league there for some time. I think at one point he had 10 goals in 10 straight games. Just talk about Stachelbeck and what he's brought to the Fury.
Yeah, classic case of getting a little bit more playing time and taking advantage of it for him coming over from Aurora. He gets the opportunity to slot in at a team that was, he came right as they were turning it around. He was a big part of that initial turnaround for this Whippy team this season. And you get hot in that top line, start playing top power play minutes. And you just take advantage of that. And now he's up there amongst the top six as far as feared scorers in the Northeast right now.
The goalie situation will be an interesting one, of course. Nate McDonald, very highly regarded keeper. Cornell commit, who's also was recently on the NHL watch list for the draft for this upcoming year. He gets traded to Markham. So now you've got, talk about the goaltending duo they've got now, who's going to have to step up in Nate's absence.
Yes, they have Luke Pearson, 16-year-old Luke Pearson, son of Rob, the coach, and he's been inserted a bit, even when McDonald was still there at the beginning part of the season, showing some signs, but he's very young. I don't think he's quite ready for the full starting role, and Whippy realized that. They picked up Alex Horoski on January 2nd. That was from Pembroke in the CCHL. He had spent some time in the AJHL with the Brooks Bandits last year, so he's been a team that's made some pretty deep playoff runs. So he's a veteran 20-year-old goaltender that gives them, it shows they're not mailing it in this season, absolutely, and picking up that goaltender right after shipping one off. And yeah, Nate McDonald's a loss, but I think they've almost made up for it. And I'd expect the 20-year-old to get the majority of the starts down the stretch. They'll insert Pearson in the back-to-backs. They'll get him in there. He's obviously probably the goalie of the future. Well, he is the goalie of the future next season with this team. But down the stretch, I'd expect to see a lot of the veteran.
Pearson's really shown some good flashes, though, hasn't he? To step in as a 16-year-old in the OJHL, and we've had him in the top five a few times with some of the saves he's made. He's really played beyond his years, hasn't he?
Yeah, the numbers don't reflect it, but a lot of that is his team in front of him. He's definitely shown some flashes of being a goalie that can be with this team for a few years, especially, again, with the family connection there and the management of the team. Yep. He should probably be with this team for a little while. There's a few 16-year-olds around the league making some noises here. Ethan Lendman is another one here in Pickering. Right. There's some good young goaltenders in the league, and he's definitely one of them.
Just under a minute to go. Let's just wrap it up for us, Alex. Of course, they're chasing Pickering for that last spot. How do you see the last month and a half shaping up here? And of course, you think Trenton might also be one of the vulnerable teams that Whitby could catch?
Yeah, I got my eyes on Trenton as well. They've played a few more games than everyone else, it seems, at this point. They're going to be caught up a bit here in January, heading into February. They're definitely catchable, but it looks like it's Pickering and Whitby two battling. And if I were to pick one, I think Pickering will hold on. However, Whitby has tried to do a scientific analysis of the schedules remaining. There's four soft games in the Whitby schedule versus two for Pickering. They've got one more home game. There's a huge game coming up in mid-January between Pickering and Whitby. I think the Whitby must win that. Pickering, it's not a must win, but I mean, if they want to be safe, they got to win that game. It's definitely possible, a lot more than a couple weeks ago. I still am going to stick with Pickering, though.
The tough part about digging yourself into that hole is that you can go on such a great streak and you still got a ways to go, don't you? That level of consistency you got to keep, but it's going to be fun to see what happens. Alex, thanks so much for joining us again and giving us your analysis, and we'll see you next time. More OJ Today coming up in just a moment. Hey folks, welcome back to the OJ Today. Well, look up the word persistence in the dictionary and you may just find a picture of the Buffalo Junior Sabres. Now, just over a month ago, the squad sat 13 points behind Georgetown for first place in the West. However, strong play by the Americans coupled with a rough stretch by the Raiders has seen Buffalo make up significant ground. And last Saturday, they had a chance to narrow that gap to just 2 points if they could take down the Raiders on the road. So Buffalo had already won both encounters with the Raiders this season, and they strike first It's controversial, though. Here's Carson Pierce. Now watch. Takes the shot off the leg, goes down like a sack of bricks. The Raiders already down a man on the penalty kill. They manage to clear the puck. The officials don't blow the whistle, though. Sabres come back the other way. Pierce is still down, and boom. Ouch. Pierce limps to the bench. The Sabres celebrate, and Raiders head coach Greg Walters, understandably, loses it on the officials, asking why they didn't blow the whistle. 1-0 Buffalo, but G-Town would hit back late in the period. Brian George with the initial stop on Jonathan Hampton. Justin Paul right there to bang home the rebound, and it's all tied up at one apiece. Second period now, and the Raiders were once again up in arms. Josh Nixon banging away at the puck. The referee loses sight of it, blows the whistle just as Nixon puts it in. Georgetown just couldn't get a break, and here's more evidence of that. Watch as Jack Miller's point shot deflects off G-Town's Nicholas Prestia, and in it goes. Oh boy, Sabres retake the lead. It's 2-1. Third period, the Raiders do come close. Matty McJanet right there on the doorstep, but George getting down just in time to smother it and seal the deal. So the Sabres, with that win, 3 straight over Georgetown, they climb within 2 points of the Raiders for first in the West. It's going to be entertaining watching those two squads duke it out down the stretch. Okay, the Junior Canadians trying to make up more ground on the first place Patriots in the South. It didn't look good early, though. 5:51 in. Nick Kalpuzis, point shot, and it goes 1-0 Patriots. And then a top five nominee here, Lee Lapid. Look at the soft hands. And that puts the Pats up 2-0. The Habs hit back, though. Mad scramble out front here. And then finally, Jason Pinio bangs it home, and it's a 2-1 game. Pats come right back, though. Gorgeous passing here. Tic-tac-toe. Oliver Benwell finishes it off. 3-1 Patriots at the break, and they were tossing the body around in this one. Nicholas Armaterio, sublime hit check. The layout is man, and then 11:05 in Cool Sports. Southwest Player of the Month for December, Dante Spagnuolo, makes it a 3-goal bulge, but Jack McBain wanted to make his voice heard, and he did. Off the iron and in to cut the lead to 4-2. The Pats would add one more in the third, and then more old school stuff. Nicholas Favaro laying out his man, actually gets 2 for charging. I thought it was a good hit. Anyway, Pats win 5-2. Dante Spagnuolo, a happy man after the game with his team's performance.
We battled really hard. You know, it's always a tough team playing the Junior Canes, a big rival, Toronto teams. We know they're going to come hard at us every night. And tonight was just like no other. We battled hard. We tried to play 60 full minutes, like Coach always says, and we're lucky to come out on top tonight.
Well, the Stouffville Spirit have had a tough go of things this year. Last season, the Spirit showed they had the power to surprise as the 7th-seeded squad upset 2nd-seed Markham in the first round of the postseason. Now, this year, the playoffs are looking increasingly unlikely as they've currently got the 2nd-worst record in the Northeast Conference. Aurora added to their misery last weekend. It was just a rough weekend overall for the Spirit. Pick it up in the second. Tigers already up 2-0. Joseph Mitzi makes it 3 with the tip-in out front. Midway through, though, the Spirit do get on the board. Nice feed for Ian Vuko out front. They cut the deficit to 3-1. The joy is short-lived, though. Tyler Davis bangs a pass. David Bowen, and it's 4-1 for the Cats. Third period, and they keep adding to it. The big man, James Thompson, 3:58 in, makes it 5-1 Tigers. Exactly 2 minutes later, though, Bo Binney, nice little backhand tip right there. And that gets the Spirit to within 3. But then Christian Giraudet, the future Western Michigan Bronco. What a snipe. Top 5 nominee. All Tigers on this day as they add 2 more to run away with it and make the final 8-2. Okay, a Wednesday night game for you here. The Chargers had already beaten the Raiders twice this year. G-Town hits first. Luca Durante makes the initial stop. Justin Paul puts it home, and it's 1-0 Raiders, but some sloppy play in this game. Third period, Andrew Corson David coughs it up. Brandon Yeamans to Tyler Tulio, and look into the eyes of Coach Greg Walters if you want to know his feelings on that one. Yeah. This one ended up going to overtime.
And back on the Raiders, maybe a 2-on-1 if they're lucky. Jason Smith with the puck. Smith to Court. He shoots. He scores! Andrew Court wins the game for the Georgetown Raiders. Court is in session. and the Raiders win. The Raiders win in double overtime, thanks to the veteran Andrew Court.
The great call by Alan Cork. And look at the players of the month brought to you by Cool Sports. And here they are. Jake Bricknell wins the Cool Northeast Player of the Month. Huge month, 21 points. Dante Spagnuolo, as mentioned, of the Pats, gets the Cool Southwest Player of the Month. 22 points in the month for December. And Colby Muse of North York, Cool Goaltender of the Month. Congrats to all three. OJ standings. Newmarket, slim lead in the north over top of Aurora, followed by Markham, Pickering, Stouffville, and Lindsay. In the east, Wellington, still a comfy 12-point lead over Kingston, followed by Cobourg, then Trenton, and Whitby with 29 points. In the south, look how tight that is. The Patriots, slim lead over Oakville, followed by North York. The GRC starting to slip just a little bit, then St. Mike's and Mississauga in sixth. And in the west, what a battle this is going to be. Georgetown, a 5-point lead right now over Buffalo, followed by the Orangeville Flyers. Burlington Cougars with 29, and Milton in fifth with 6 points. Hey folks, welcome back to the OJ Today. Well, these days, most know Zach Hyman as a dynamic young forward paired with superstar Austin Matthews on the top line of the Toronto Maple Leafs. But Zach's connections to the OJHL run deep. He was a standout with the Hamilton Red Wings, even notching the National Junior A Player of the Year award before heading to the University of Michigan on a scholarship. These days, he's living out his dream, playing for his hometown Leafs. And we caught up with Zach last week.
Oh, and a big pad save made by Lundqvist, right leg. Stolen again. Hyman in.
Sights like this have become a common occurrence over the last three seasons in Toronto, as 25-year-old Zach Hyman has cemented himself as a top contributor to the Maple Leafs. But Zach's path to the NHL didn't go through Major Junior. Rather, he was a superstar in the OJHL with the Hamilton Red Wings from 2008 through 2011.
Yeah, it was awesome. I was there for 3 years. Got to kind of see the city a little bit, and it was a great city to play in. I love playing in Hamilton. I got to play with my brother Spence, and that was awesome. It was really cool, and had great teams when we were there, and had a lot of fun and developed, so it was good.
Zach was drafted in the fifth round by the Florida Panthers after a standout season in 2010. But the season OJHL fans still talk about is Zach's 2010-2011 campaign. Playing with his brother Spencer in Hamilton, Hyman was a force to be reckoned with. He tallied 102 points in just 43 regular season games as an 18-year-old, and he was named the top player in all of Canadian Junior A hockey.
Yeah, that was a special year for sure. That was really fun. We had a great team. I played with some really good players, and it was a big year for my development as a player, and it helped me get to the University of Michigan, and from there kind of develop into an NHL prospect.
With his focus on education as much as hockey, Zach elected to go to the NCAA over the OHL, and his choice of program was the cream of the crop, as Hyman spent 4 years at the University of Michigan under famed head coach Red Berenson. Zach excelled as a Wolverine and was named a finalist for the Hobey Baker Award in his fourth and final season, given to the top player in all of college hockey.
Yeah, Michigan was surreal. It's everything that I hoped for in university. I had a lot of fun playing there. I went in as a high-scoring player, and then I think I came out as a two-way player, and kind of made me into an NHL-ready player, and really grateful for the coaching staff that was there. Red Berenson was really impactful on my career, and I wouldn't be where I am today without his help, and the University of Michigan as a whole was just an unbelievable program to be a part of.
Hyman never played a game for the Florida Panthers. Instead, he was traded to the Leafs back in 2015. And since then, he's become a favorite of head coach Mike Babcock for his hardworking, selfless play and 200-foot game. A Toronto boy playing for his hometown team on the first line with Austin Matthews and William Nylander.
Yeah, it's a dream. It's a dream come true. Your goal is always to make the NHL, and you always have in the back of your head that you want to play for your hometown team. And it's tough. There's 31 other teams in the league now, and I was lucky enough to be traded to my hometown team and have the opportunity to play for the Leafs. And then having that first game, first goal, all those milestones were just incredible, and just looking forward to keep building here. And it's just been an unbelievable experience, and something that I'm really grateful and privileged to be a part of the team.
Zach's not just a professional athlete, however. He's also a best-selling children's novelist. His love of writing began at a young age.
I'm the oldest of five boys, so being the oldest, you kind of want to make stories for brothers, be creative, so that kind of is where the writing was inspired from and came from. And I got three books out now. The first two are Hockey Hero and The Bambino and Me. And the third one's The Magician's Secret, which comes out in April 2018. So I just love writing. It's a good outlet for hockey. I think everybody needs to have something else to express themselves. And writing is just something that I love. It's a passion of mine, and I love doing it.
The Leafs this season have quite the OJHL flavor to them, with grads including St. Mike's Mitch Marner and Connor Brown, and now Newmarket's Travis Dermott. And Hyman views his time in the OJ as essential to his development.
Yeah, I was there for 3 years. I was there my 16, 17, and 18 year-old year, and those 3 years are important years for development and for growth, and the OJHL was a great league to develop as a player and just kind of learn what kind of game you need to have to get to the next level, and it was a great 3 years.
Okay, before we go, the top five brought to you by Chaos, the official hat provider to the OJHL. And number five, Markham's Justin Bennett going roof daddy on Stouffville's Andrew Albano in a blowout Royals win last weekend. Number four, Lee Lapid, soft hands against the JRCs as he too goes top shelf to beat the keeper. Number three, Aurora's Christopher Giraudet, and this baby was on a rope. The future Western Michigan Bronco with a sweet goal and a lopsided Tigers win. Number two, Buffalo's Brian George came up big all weekend. Here he gets over to stop the point blank shot by the JRC's David Sherman. And that is gorgeous. And number one, the man they call Captain Kirk, Newmarket's Fraser Kirk, absolutely robs Kingston. Now, we'll take a closer look. The first save is nice, but the follow-up as he spins and gets the paddle down, beautiful. Definitely our Chaos play of the week. And that's all the time we've got for this week, but just remember, folks, to keep up to date with everything regarding the OJHL, all your news, stats, standings, and stories, you can always head to ojhl.ca. And of course, you've got all your social media options to check out there as well. Thanks for tuning in, folks. We'll see you next week.